Well, I'd like to thank all 10 of you for coming. I know it's late in the day, but try and get everybody out here as soon as possible because I imagine everybody's hungry by this point. So if you hear stomach growling through the microphone, it's probably mine. But I'd like to welcome you to Active Directory, Real Defense for Domain Admins. Before we get too much into the technical nitty-gritty, I want to give you a disclaimer. It's not the standard run-of-the-mill disclaimer, you know, my thoughts are my own, et cetera, but there's a little more behind it. One of my pet peeves when going into a conference talk is you read the abstract and you're like, this talk is going to be amazing. And you sit there and 10 minutes goes by and they're still in the warm-up. Then 20 minutes goes by and they're like, when are they going to get to it? Now you're on your phone, now you're starting to fall asleep. So I'm going to tell you exactly what this talk is about and what it's not about. That way, if you want to go do something else, you are absolutely free to do so. So just trying to be respectful of your time. This is a defense talk. So there is no sexy 0 days here. I'm not going to be dropping anything against Active Directory. Okay, this is simply tips and tricks from one blue team person to hopefully a bunch of other blue team people. So that's really the driver behind this. It is definitely geared towards the enterprise. If you are a small shop, this is going, there will be stuff in here for everybody, but the terminology that I'm going to use is really much more geared towards the enterprise. So shops have thousands of users or more. And that's just intentional because that's my background. So the last thing is that, you know, this is really geared towards domain administrator accounts and security on your domain controllers. This talk is not going to solve all of your Active Directory security problems. People way, way, way smarter than me write books about that kind of stuff, and we can go get that. But you know, this is simple tips and tricks, kind of ground floor stuff to help you improve the security of your Active Directory. So that's really what this is about, and nobody's left yet, so I imagine you all want to be here. So goals, simple, let's talk through a little bit of the goals. First, I want to provide content that's immediately useful to you for the security of your domain administrator accounts as well as your domain controllers. Okay, like I said, this is not a wide talk about Active Directory security. I'll leave that to the professionals. So this is really focused on, and I have to be specific because I only have a limited amount of time, but this is really focused on your domain admin accounts as well as your domain controllers. I want to give you projects that you can implement in a month or less. And I'm specific about that because, you know, how often have you gone to a conference talk and you hear somebody get up there and speak and you're like, this is amazing, I love all this stuff. And then you try and bring it back in your environment and you realize it's going to take 2 years in order to get from A to B. And there's three other steps beyond that because there's committees and then there's committees about committees and you have to get all kinds of approval and et cetera, et cetera. It's just a lot of red tape, right? So this is specifically designed to give you things that you can do in a quick amount of time to directly improve security. Like I said, a month or less. Some of these are just check boxes you have to check. Some of them are creating user accounts in a specific fashion, but they're specifically designed to help you improve security of Active Directory regarding domain admins and domain controllers, okay? The last goal that I want to give you is that I'm going to be discussing some of the pen test results that we went through as an organization. I have a very specific goal of not getting fired, so if you ask me very, very specific questions about the pen test, you're going to get very non-specific answers, so just FYI. Just a little bit about me. I'm a security engineer at a Fortune 500 company that does financial services. My passions are development. I love C#, PowerShell, Python, I love it all. InfoSec, and when I'm not doing InfoSec stuff, I'm going to be in my shop pushing a jack plane. So woodworking is definitely a passion of mine. But you find me on Twitter, and occasionally I post out of Project 500. So quick survey, quick show of hands. How many of you work in a large enterprise? By large, we'll say 5,000 users or more. Wow, that's almost everybody. That's outstanding. Okay, so how many of you are involved in some way in the security of Active Directory, whether you're a domain admin or an enterprise admin or you write policy for AD, whatever that is? Okay, cool. And how many of you have gone through a pen test sometime in the last 12 months? Quite a few of you. Okay, any red teamers here? All right, so the pen test results, did they go something like this? I imagine they probably did, right? Red team shows up, they own your whole domain in the span of a couple days or a couple hours, and blue team is left just kind of, oh, and that's about it, and red team leaves. And they hand you this nice flashy report, right? So in our environment, last year, we hired a company, feedback. We hired a company, a small, teeny, tiny company based out of Ohio. If I told you their name, you would have no idea who they are. And we, We brought them in and we said, hey, why don't you test our environment? Okay, so Trust Day comes in, and a couple weeks goes by, and my friend Scott, who was kind of, he was heading up the pen test, kind of the liaison between our company and Trusted Sec. He says, hey, Jason, you need to go out and check the domain admins group. And I'm like, this is not going to be good. So I go out and I check the domain admin. And I'm telling you, when you see something like this, the light goes on in a way that it has not gone on previously. Okay, if you work strictly blue team and you have not gone through a pen test, your theoretical knowledge of what can be done against your domain is kind of pie in the sky. You know that there's a risk. You know that if you're a domain admin or an enterprise admin or you have any kind of elevated access, you might be a target, but you're not necessarily going to have an intimate knowledge of that until somebody comes in and basically rapes your domain, okay? Which is kind of what happens in this case. And so I look at this and I'm thinking to myself, how did he do that? Okay, I'm aware of some of the attack vectors, you know, and some of the vulnerabilities in our domain, but I think to myself, in order to make a domain admin account, he has to be a domain admin. So now I'm running through the list of domain admins thinking, whose account did he get? All right, and this is kind of, it's terrifying for me to actually even have this slide even up there, okay? But what's important about this is, and what I'm trying to communicate, is that if you are a domain administrator or even have some kind of elevated access, maybe you're not domain admin, maybe you're way above that, maybe you're enterprise admin over a ton of child domains, okay? You are a target. And I need this to be cemented into your head, because if a pen tester gets into your environment or attacker gets in your environment and then they get domain user access, what are they going to do? They're going to do net group domain admin slash domain, and they're going to see what the domain admins are, and that's what they're going to go after. Okay, if this concept is not solidified for you, let me show you this. Matt Weeks, you might know him as a script junkie, he put this slide together, gave me permission to use it. This is the network intrusion process. So you're not necessarily going to see all the stuff in here. I know the font is way too small, but don't worry about that. Worry about this, where it says start, and you go through some stuff over here, and you go through some attacks, and you become a limited user, and then you go through some more attacks, and you become a local admin, more attacks, and look where you end up. Domain app. Okay, he sells these. You can buy them off Zazzle, I think. I'm not sure what the link is, but I can get for you if you're interested. But the point being, you start here with nothing, you end here with this. Domain admin is admittedly one of the crown jewels of any attacker, right? That's what they're going to try and get. If they get domain admin, they're going to post a screenshot of themselves logged in, or they're going to post a screenshot of this, and they're going to hand it to you, and you're just going to cry. Or at least that's what I did. Right? So they're going to show you this. So seeing this in our environment, like I said, the light bulb came on for us in a very real way. And so the driver behind this talk is to give you tips and tricks of things that you can do. I got 10 things lined up. Things that you can do that are going to improve the security of your Active Directory, and like I said, hopefully very quickly. Trying to make changes to a group policy in an enterprise can be like steering the Titanic. Okay, you have to get all kinds of approvals from your change and config board, and then your change approval board, and meetings for meetings, and you know, just all the red tape crap that you have to deal with in an enterprise. So hopefully these are going to go quickly. So you'll see me line up something of a methodology here. So I apologize. Some of them are disjointed thoughts that you're going to get from me, but some of them are definitely related. But number one has nothing to do with technology at all. It has everything to do with people. So number one, test your domain admins. And what do I mean by this? I actually mean give them a technical challenge. Okay, it's not sufficient that you know they're going through your manager is hiring somebody who has AD experience, right? And they're going through the interview process, and they're like, do you have any AD experience? And the guy's like, yeah, I wrote Active Directory. The manager's like, okay, pfft, hired. No, that's not sufficient. Okay, all right, so you bring somebody into your team, and they're like, I wrote the LDAP RFC. No, that does not work. And this is especially true with vendors, right? Vendors come in, they want you to think that they are God's gift to whatever it is they're selling you, okay, and how often is it proven that that is just not the case? So when I say test your domain admins, let me give you a story. There's a young guy that joined our team a couple years ago, Sam. He's here, right there. That's Sam. and Sam joined our team a couple years ago. And Sam's one of those guys, he's really easy to love. Okay, he comes in, he tells you jokes, he kind of wins you over, you become friends with him really quickly. And Sam came in with a comp sci background, okay, didn't really know much about security, and, you know, but started coding against Active Directory. All right, Sam's a developer, likes to write C#, so he starts coding against Active Directory, and he starts getting more and more interested. And so finally, you know, we pulled him aside and we said, hey, Sam, are you interested in doing more AD work? And he's like, yeah. I said, all right, so let's take Sam to some meetings. So we brought Sam to some meetings, and we delegated some access to him, and he starts taking on more and more work. Until finally the day came when Sam was pretty good at what he was doing. And so we said, all right, should we make him a domain admin? And the other guys are like, yeah. They're like, well, let's test him first. Let's see what Sam can do. Initiation. Yes, absolutely. Okay. So in one of the test domains, I got a broken domain controller. It's throwing a corrupt database error. Sam will probably tell you exactly what the error was. Okay, it's some kind of corrupt database error, and replication was not occurring. So I said, okay, Sam, here's how you pass. You have to fix replication, and you have to take screenshots of all the commands that you tried so you can demonstrate the methodology that you went through in order to fix it. Okay, that's how you pass. How you fail is if you break authentication, users get domain not available. Okay, so you break authentication, or if you can fix it, but you don't document your process, okay? It's very important that we understand what it is that you went through, the commands that you tried. I had a few specific commands in my head that I thought would fix it, and I wanted to see if Sam would do that. Turns out he tried all of it. All right, so Sam disappears for a few weeks, he comes back, hands me a bunch of screenshots that demonstrates replication is working, tried all the commands that I was hoping he would try, and what's most important is he asked the right questions of the right people. He didn't just go to another domain admin and say, hey, help me fix this. He asked questions about the technology, did his own research. Okay, so now, when Sam goes to a meeting, I know that I can trust him to do the right things and ask the right questions. He has that sense of humility about him. Okay, he's not going to go in all cavalier and just start doing authoritative restores all over the place. It's not going to work like that. Okay, so test your domain admins. It's very, very important that you do that. All right, testing is a proving ground for trust. All right, number two, limit the number of domain admins that you have. So in my previous company, there was 1,500 employees, and there was 35 domain administrators. Now, to some of you, that might seem like a lot, and it should. I'm worried about those of you who are like, 35, that's nothing, you know? Yeah, we got 100. So in my current company, there's about 20,000 employees, and there are 5 domain administrators, okay? Lots and lots of child domains enforced. And LDAP is just one of the things we have to worry about, okay? We worry about crypto and security architecture and security posture and all that other kind of stuff. So it's like, how do you do that? Well, each one of our domain administrators is very, very good at automation. They know how to write code in a few different languages. Okay, it is important that you know how to do that. But if you don't limit your domain admins, you get domain admins like me a couple of jobs ago. So at a previous company, my previous company, we were doing a Windows NT to Windows 2000 migration. Starting to date myself here, it's crazy. So we're doing this migration, and I was a domain admin at the Madison branch office, and they decided to sync a domain controller in the Madison office, and I was the only IT guy there. And so I was used to working with the master-slave model of Windows NT. Anybody here remember Windows NT? Nobody. Okay. So I was used to working with that model, and I'm working on this, and I'm like, yeah, this is no big deal. So they put a domain controller in the Madison office, and I log in with a domain admin, untested, young guy, I don't know anything. Right? But I log in with domain admin credentials, and I'm like, I'm going to lock this thing down. So I log in, and I start looking over the domain controller, and I come across this share, sysvol. So I look at the sysvol share, and I right-click properties, go to security, and I start looking through the ACL, and I'm like, authenticated users? That's everybody. Take that off. This is a true story, by the way. I take that off, and then I put myself on with full control. Let's not get stupid. I need access, right? I'm the admin. And then I click apply, and I walk home. This is, like I said, this is a true story. My manager in the front row, he's looking at me. Yeah. I didn't tell you that story in the interview? No, I thought for sure I did. So come in the next day, and there's a line of users that are waiting to talk to me. And they're like, Jason, I can't get logged in. So I go to their workstation, and it just says, domain not available. And I'm like, domain not available, domain not available. Yeah, I have no idea. hey, we're about to call the home office. Well, the home office called me because they looked at the ACL and saw my ID. Like, Jason, did you take off authenticated users? And I'm like, well, yeah, that gave access to everybody. You put yourself on there? Yeah. Yeah, they promptly took me out of the domain admins group, which is exactly what they should have done. I never should have been in the domain admins group because I was untested and didn't know anything. Okay, so good security, I'm a firm believer, good security does not start with blinky appliances. Good security starts with good people. So bring in good people, test them, but keep them limited. Don't just grant domain admin access to everybody, okay? Let's get into some of the technical stuff. So separate your domain admin accounts from your everyday account. This is critical. So what we're going to do is, over the next few bullet points, we're going to build up a methodology whereby we can mitigate attacks like pass the hash. Okay, so it's going to start with something like this. So if you're a domain admin, you're looking at me and you're like, that means, so if I have two accounts, and one of them's domain admin, and then my everyday account is not a domain admin, then I'm not going to log in with domain admin credentials. And that's exactly what you're going to do. Okay, so you're going to restrict your own account, and you're going to have a separate account that's dedicated to doing domain administrative work. It's really, really simple. Create an account, put in domain admins, take domain admins away from your day-to-day account. Done. Okay, and it only impacts you. All right, yeah, you might have to get approval in order to make a change to your domain, but you're not impacting the whole company. You're just impacting you and hopefully the rest of the domain admins. Okay, so start with that. Number two, separate the DA password policy. And what I mean by that is, if you are an intrepid domain administrator, you're looking at me and you're going to say something like, well, the password policy, in group policy, that's a computer configuration object setting, which means if I change that, I'm going to be applying that to all computers. Well, Microsoft already thought of this, and in Windows Server 2008, they introduced something called fine-grained password policy objects. Everybody heard of this? Okay. What this does is, this is a object that you can configure in Active Directory, and it applies to a group of users. You do not have to impact everybody. You can create this object. In fact, there's some PowerShell to do it. You can create this object, and it will apply only to a specific group, and it's extremely handy. Okay, because if your company is old, and by old I mean 20 years or greater, okay, and your business is freaking out at the prospect of going from a 5-character minimum to a 6-character minimum, okay, this is for you. All right, so in this particular case, so I'm creating a password policy, I got a title of some variable, so I'm setting complexity to true, lockout duration to forever. This is important, set precedence to 1, because what you want to do is you want to supersede the default domain password policy with this much tighter password policy for your domain administrators. Okay, and in this case, minimum password length of 12. Okay, that's what I would recommend as a good starting point. You red teamers, you might look at me and laugh, but it's going to be better than what is probably your default on your default domain right now, right? So you've separated your domain admin access from your everyday access. You've given a much tighter password policy. Okay, next step, this is where some of the magic happens. Set domain admin login restrictions to your domain controllers only. Okay, so now we've split off domain admin, but you can still log into that account with everywhere, and what you're doing is you're spreading your domain admin hash all over the network. Okay, in this case, what we're doing is we're going to take that Microsoft, they give you a handy little button here called logon to. You pull this up in your user object, you click logon to, and in all your DCs go in there. Okay, it's very, very simple, very straightforward, and oh, by the way, it only impacts you. You're not changing this for the whole business. Okay. So you put all your domain controllers in here. Now your domain admin account can only log into your domain controllers. Do you see what we're doing? We're taking the scope of domain admin access, we're reining it in, okay? So now you can only log into your DCs. All right, and once that's done, now let's take the next step, disable cache credentials. Really, really easy to do through group policy. Okay, so you pull up group policy, you pull up computer config settings, security options, and number of previous logins to cache, set this to 0. Okay, and I don't recommend you just do this for domain controllers. I recommend you do this for all your servers. Now, before you panic, think this through for a second. You take all your servers. If you're in an enterprise, where are all of your servers? In the data center. Exactly. Okay, so let's talk about a worst case scenario. Your servers in the domain center, they're running happily, they're connected to the domain. All right, a squirrel comes in, chews through your last Cat5 cable, and it's gone. And so now you got the server that is not connected to the network any longer, and you've turned off cache credentials. What are you probably going to log in with anyways? You're probably going to log in with the SID 500 account, with the local administrator account. Okay, so you don't need cache credentials running on your server. Yeah, you might need it on your workstations for remote users, but you don't need it running on your servers, and you don't need it running on your domain controllers. So think through what we've done just in these steps, okay? You've separated out your domain admins, much better password policy. They can only log into domain controllers where, oh, by the way, there are now no password hashes. In my opinion, that's an effective mitigation strategy for attacks like pass the hash. So how do you prevent pass the hash? You don't give them the hash to begin with. They can't pass what they don't have. Okay? So once that's done, funny story about this. So cache credentials. This is kind of embarrassing. But when we finished the pen test of our organization, Scott told me that Dave, he made it to domain admin on our network. And so I pulled Dave up, and I sent him a text. I'm like, Dave, I was like, whose account did you get? And he's like, I don't want to tell you. And I'm like, Dave, whose account did you get? He's like, I don't want to tell you. I'm like, I'm the customer. Is it going to be in your report? He's like, I feel really bad about it. And I'm like, what are you talking about? And so he tells me the account. And I'm like, okay, it's a friend of mine, domain admin friend of mine. And I'm like, all right, what's the big deal? It could have been my account. And then he tells me the password. And he told me the password, and I understood why he felt so bad. The password was DerbyCon Rocks. And I was like, oh, sleep well, Dave. Sleep. I hope you're happy. He's like, I'm not going to sleep. By the way, that's not the password anymore, just FYI. So you have cache credentials turned off, right? Next, be careful with your domain admin service accounts. It's back on now. We good to go? For the moment, right? So be careful with your domain admin service accounts. What I mean by that is every domain administrator loves to have domain admin service accounts. Why is that? You're going to set up a task server, and you're going to run a bunch of scheduled tasks, and what are those tasks going to do? It's going to take these thousands of users, and it's going to give them job code X, or department code Y, or it's going to put them in this group and take them out of this group. It's doing user admin stuff, most likely, right? There are very, very few things that I can think of that actually require domain admin access in order to do as far as tasks are concerned. Maybe IPsec policy management, but how many are you running IPsec in your environment? So probably not many of you. So be careful with your domain admin service accounts. If you do have to have a domain admin service account, okay, actually let me back up, delegate your access. Number one, you can delegate everything, almost everything in Active Directory. AD is not one of those technologies where it's like you get five out of the box roles. There's like thousands of combinations that you can do for delegation. So what is the real reason why domain admins create a service account that has domain admin access? You want to take a guess? What's the real reason? What? Lazy. Yes, they're lazy. I can only point fingers back at me because I've done that in the past as well. That is the real reason, okay? But if you delegate your access, you don't need it. But let's say for whatever reason, you come across a scenario where you do need a domain admin service account. So what you do is you take that task server and you treat it like a domain controller. Okay, you apply the exact same configurations to it. You shut off cache credentials, and you take that service account, and you configure it so it can only log into the domain controller. So what you're effectively doing is bringing that server into the trusted fold, so to speak, of servers where cache creds are turned off, okay, and the account that's the domain admin account can only log into that server. All right, so the methodology is the same. Now, I'm applying this to domain administrators, but you can apply it to any other class of privileged account, your PKI admins. You can apply it to any other class of account. It's the same principles, okay? So next thing is the Microsoft Security Compliance Manager. How many of you heard of this tool? Two, three, a couple of you? Okay, that's all. That was actually more than I was thinking. How many of you have used it in your environment? Two people, three people, okay? This tool is, in my opinion, very handy to have, especially for the busy administrator. So how many of you have ever been in the situation where somebody comes up to you, especially if you're in an enterprise, somebody comes up to you and they're like, hey, Jason, I have a new, we're rolling out a new operating system and we need a secure group policy for it. What do we do? Can you create one? And you're like, yeah, sure. So you create a new group policy object. You look through all 500 settings, all right? And if you're lucky, you have enough time to click explain and read through it, and then you're like, well, yeah, we'll set this, and this looks good, and this looks good, and what are you doing? You're basically guessing. And if you wonder what the best practices are from Microsoft, and you Google that, you're gonna come across a spreadsheet that Microsoft puts out that has all the group policy settings and all the registry settings that they correspond to, but it's not gonna tell you where to set them to. That's exactly what this tool is designed to do. You probably cannot see this, but over here on the left, there's a list of operating systems. So in this case, I'm drilling into Windows Server 2008 R2. And down here are the roles. So member server role, domain controller role, Exchange. Okay, you can pick the role, and over here on the right, you have the default settings that come for that group policy, and then you have the Microsoft recommended setting for that group policy. Now, this is not a tool that is, just best practices for group policy in general. This is with a security focus. This is the security compliance manager tool, okay? And so this exact same scenario happened to me. The server team comes to me and they're like, Jason, we want to roll out Server 2012. And I'm like, okay, I only have 20 other projects on my plate, but if we can get this right, you know, then this will set the stage for all future secure 2012 servers, right? So put the other projects on hold, pick this one up, grab this tool, drill into Server 2012, yep, because they got it right there, all right, and run through the policy, make a few changes to suit our environment, and now we have a secure group policy that we can roll out for Server 2012. Makes life a whole lot easier. What you can't see over all the way to the right is all the options for things like back up your group policy and export to Excel and export to CSV, and then you can import it into a group policy object in your domain. Microsoft made it really, really easy because they know that a lot of guesswork goes into group policy. So this is all this is just another tool in your toolbox. That's all this was designed to do. Okay, so that's Security Compliance Manager. Oh, by the way, it's free. You don't have to pay for it. Just go get it. I want to give you a quick word about null sessions. Everybody shake your head if you know what null sessions are and why they're bad. Okay, all right. So null session, an unauthenticated session to your domain controller, allows you to do basic enumeration against things like password policies and groups and stuff like that, right? So the problem is that if you get a report, and on that report says you are vulnerable to null sessions, and you work in a huge enterprise, you think to yourself, okay, I can manipulate the group policy settings to shut that off, but what am I going to break? See, this is the problem with being on the blue side of that pen test. They drop off the report, and they show you all of the various ways that you suck, and you're looking this over, and you're like, how do I fix this stuff? And you come across null sessions, and you're like, well, that's about 5 or 6 group policy changes against my domain controllers. But if you are in an organization that is 20 years or older, 10 years or older, okay, security 10 years ago is not what security is today. It is entirely possible, if not likely, that there are applications that are making legitimate use of null sessions against your domain controllers. Why? Because that was the norm. It was available. Okay, it could be done, and it could be done, and nobody questioned it. Security people didn't even question it, right? And so this is where things get tricky, because if you just go in, flip some switches, and shut them off, you could be breaking legitimate business apps. And the problem is that security on the blue side always serves the business. This is why Blue Team has it so hard. Blue Team does not serve itself. Blue Team serves the business. Here, I see heads nodding. Okay, if you're in the enterprise, you understand this concept. You can't just go in and no access for everybody, the most secure thing, right? Just delete all the data. You can't do that. You serve the business. Okay, and so you can't just take a setting or take a vulnerability like null sessions and just shut it off because you're breaking stuff. All right, so this is number 9 is just another tool in the toolbox. All it is I wanted to give you all some PowerShell code. I know you can't see this, but I'll make the slides available. So all this is just a simple, quick command, get AD domain, grab all your domain controllers, and all this is just some WMI. It's just a WMI connection against your domain controllers that says, hey, give me all the sessions where the username equals nothing. Okay, in this case, it throws back here. This interrogates all of your domain controllers. Now, you can do this with net session. So if you go into your domain controller and just type in net session, you'll actually see null sessions, but it's only valid for that domain controller. It can be a pain to script around that. So this interrogates all of your DCs. And the good news about this, so this right here is an example. That's my Kali workstation. So, and this is just using RPC client to hit my domain controller with a null session. Okay, so all this is designed to do is, I mean, you can Google how to fix null sessions in your environment. In fact, on Project 500, I don't know if any of you caught that, I have an article about detecting and repairing null sessions. So in your environment, but we'll get into that a little bit later as well. So Like I said, another tool in your toolbox to help you figure out, before I just shut this down, what am I going to be breaking? In our environment, found a whole bunch of machines that were making null session connections. We have an old company, okay, and they were legitimate. All right, and this is something that we have to concern ourselves with. So like I said, tool in the toolbox. And the last thing, and this is one thing that I'm kind of passionate about, so for some personal reasons, I'll explain in a minute. Get offensive security training. And by offensive security, I don't necessarily mean offensive security company, though I would happily recommend them. I finished up going through the OSCP program, and I'm going to tell you something. When you go through that, as a blue team person, the light bulbs go on in ways that they probably have never gone on for you before if you've never taken that kind of training. So if you look at a setting like this, network access, allow anonymous SID name translation. Okay, and you click explain, it's basically going to tell you what you already know. If you set this to disabled, it's going to disable allow anonymous SID name translation. Does anybody know what tool or what technique makes use of that? Grid cycling, right? So this is just a tool, this is just a Enum for Linux running on my Kali workstation targeting my domain controller with this setting set to not defined, okay? And so what's coming back, you see, I get the administrator account, I get the, what is that, curbTGT? I get the curbTGT account, you know, and then go through and you can pick off users and you can pick off groups. But once I have that information, I can build a word list. Now I have a word list, I can do brute force attacks, okay? But if you configure the setting to disabled, and you come back and you run the same tool, now you get access denied. I had no idea how to do this until early this year when I first started going through the course and started teaching this stuff. Because before, it was all theoretical. You look at this and you're like, yeah, I want to set this to disabled. I don't want anonymous access, but I have no idea why. Okay, when you go through offensive training, you understand the tools and techniques that are used to attack your domain and are used to compromise your machines. And so I wish I could give you the double fist pump that I did when I went through this exercise. I had one monitor that was Kali and another monitor that was my test domain controller. And what I did, the exercise that I did was I had group policy settings and I was making group policy changes over here and then sending attacks against the domain to see what the impact was of doing that. Okay, but you don't necessarily know to do that unless you know what those attack vectors are and what those tools are, right? So I can't emphasize that enough. If you need a recommendation, yes, go with Offensive Security, the company. The OSCP program is fantastic. So, and anyways, this is an interesting segue for me because I was following, who was it on Twitter? I think it was Chris Gates that posted this picture. He was at a CCDC competition and tweeted this. So he was on the red team and he went and had physical access to the blue team's world, apparently, and came across the Windows security checklist. So step one, create some users, add them to the main admins group. Here's the passwords. Change the default admin password, and then here comes the security checklist. Check. Disable the local guest and administrator on all machines. And that's it. And I look at this, and I just want to reach out and give the blue team a hug. So I'm like, if you look at that, and that's the checklist, well, I've never been in a CCDC competition, but from what I read on Twitter, they basically just get owned every single year. So, I look at this, and it makes you want to cry. It makes you want to do something to help. So we actually did. A few of us put together a script called Domain Lockdown. You have to forgive me. I did not prepare a demo. I wasn't thinking I would have time, but it looks like I do have time. But I have a couple of screenshots for it. All this tool is, again, another tool in the toolbox. I know this is a lot to take in, so bear with me. I'll talk you through it. This is the evaluate switch. All evaluate does is you need to be running this on your domain controller as a domain admin because it does an RSOP to look at existing policy settings. So all this does is it goes through a lot of the checks that I just told you about. Okay, password complexity is enabled, minimum password length for domain admins is too short, domain logins are restricted to just domain controllers, looks like you're purposely not allowing null sessions. This was a domain controller that I configured to be basically insecure. Okay, I built in the null session code here to throw null sessions back to the screen. And it also checks for the anonymous SID name translation, that kind of thing. So that's the evaluate step. If you are feeling ambitious, there's a remediate flag. And all the remediate flag is go down the list here. Pass-through policy, it creates it and it sets it. That was step number four. Successfully restricts logon access for domain administrators. That was step number five. And then it uses the security compliance analyzer, creates a, it has the group policy object that I pre-configured for 2008 domain controllers, unpacks it, and if you want, we'll apply it to your domain controllers OU. Okay, highly recommend that you do this in a test environment. If you do it in a prod environment, well, yeah, anyways. So, but yeah, please test this before running it in prod. Okay, you can pick it up at GitHub link here. And I think that's about it. Any questions? Yeah, that's all I had. I wasn't given any tickets. Oh, shoot, I have two tickets. How about that? If nobody has any questions, I'll just give the tickets away. Go ahead. Outstanding. Everybody hear that? Side benefit for using the fine-grained password policy is that if you're an attacker, you can't necessarily see that. Which means if your domain accounts, your default domain password policy is set to lock out after 10 bad attempts, but you configure fine-grained password policy to lock out after 5 attempts, bad guys who are trying to run silently are going to lock your accounts but not know they locked your accounts. Okay, and that's going to set up red flags. So, outstanding point. Anybody else? Wow. That's it. Enjoy your dinner. Thanks for coming.